Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Topic Time with Harrison Young. September 14th, 2016. It is a very nice, I wouldn't call it, I guess this can't really say Indian summer day because it's still officially summer. Indian summer, I guess, can only occur once fall kicks in, and then, you know, it's warmer than it's expected to be, and that's nice, and it's a very nice day anyway. And the circumstances of tonight's show are a little unique. The fact is, I actually have two awesome guests that just met this evening. They're both actors. We're going to talk to both of them tonight. I needed one guest, and I got two for the price of one. We have this gentleman here next to me is Arthur Hugh, the dialed up guy with the slick tunic on here, and the gentleman next to him kind of looks like Larry David. This is Paul Kandarian.
You get that a lot.
Yeah, I know you do. I know he's got that. He said Bernie Sanders.
Bernie Sanders.
You put your glasses on, you look like Bernie. Without the glasses, you look like.
That's better.
Yeah, there you go. That's Larry David, man. I don't see Bernie as much.
He's way better.
You're way more rugged than Bernie Sanders. Yeah. No offense, Bernie, if you're watching the show when it is. Gentlemen, laugh a little. Let's have some fun. We always have fun on Topic Time. We never take ourselves too seriously, right?
No.
Okay.
No.
So you're both actors, and Paul, you're also a journalist.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's talk about. Don't worry. We'll get both of you guys covered thoroughly. But Paul, I mean, because you do that, I want to find out about how long you've been doing it and how you became a journalist and where you write and what your column is about.
Oh God.
You can just break it down. You don't have to go off the whole nine yards.
It's a hideously long story. But the short version.
Short version.
Taunton Gazette. I started at the Taunton Gazette.
Okay.
In 82 as a freelancer, then I became full-time staffer in 83, and I was there until 97, and then I quit the freelance, and I've been freelancing since 1997.
Wait a minute, you just said you quit the freelancing.
I quit
two freelancers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And then I became an actor about 9 years ago, so I always like to say I could not find two of the least certain occupations, an actor and writer, as far as like job security, but it's the most fun.
It is, I understand that. But you've been a writer longer than you've been an actor.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Not counting real life, which we're all actors.
We're all actors in the stage of life, question about it. All right, now we're gonna take turns. Now, Arthur, tell me about how you. Now you got you have 27 IMDb credits. You told me that before.
Right.
So let's talk.
A lot of them are for background, though.
Okay. Yeah, but
you know,
I know, but hopefully after tonight's show, that'll change.
Of course.
Awesome.
that's what our goal is.
Exactly. It absolutely is. We all want to. You know, we all just want to be big rock stars, right?
You're already a rock star.
Oh, I am. Yeah, but guys like you, people like you, it wouldn't happen. I need to.
Right.
Well, all right. Well, let's talk about how you. Because you've got so many, talk about how you got started in acting. I profile everybody thoroughly. So Arthur, because we kind of got you on the rebound, what were you like as a kid, and how did I assume that sort of led into your acting career?
As a kid, I was like shy and skinny and very. You know, I was the youngest of four. Three boys and a girl.
Okay,
but I was the youngest.
Still, that's kind of overwhelming.
I was sort of like the baby, so I was treated like that.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But I had a good childhood, but I got started in acting. I think that's where you're going with
correct.
This. In fourth grade.
Okay.
So,
I was in a play.
I grew up in Peabody on the North Shore.
Got it. Great
so,
town.
I love it, and I still live there.
Still live there.
But I got started in acting at like age 9, I guess, in fourth grade, however old you are at that age.
Correct, yeah.
In school. And it was in a Christmas play called Tweedledee Plays a Bad Joke.
Oh, cool.
And I was the main character, so I got
to... I love the title. Was this sort of an offshoot of one of the Dickens tales written by one of his...
I don't know who wrote it. I really don't remember, but I was cast as the main character.
Okay.
And it was like a theatrical... opportunity for me to showcase my physical attributes.
Well, I got to tell you, it sounds like a parody. Was it a parody?
It was a parody.
Oh, good.
Yeah, but I was in fourth grade, so
I know,
my memory's a little bit fuzzy with, you know.
You don't have the photographic memory from Asperger's that I do.
I have a photographic memory, not as
explicit as me.
Explicit as you or as, you know.
Well, what exactly was the character you played?
I played Tweedledee, which was like one of Santa's elves.
Okay.
And so I got to like experiment and explore the stage, and it gave me confidence. And I was an athlete, so it gave me
Well, you just said you were skinny as a kid. Now, you were an athlete in the fourth
grade,
too. You look athletic now, too. But
well, yeah, you know, I'm a little bit bigger than I was then.
Yeah, I'm sure you are.
But at that time, I was kind of shy.
Okay.
And I got the opportunity once I realized that I was good at certain things, like being on stage wasn't a problem for me.
Right.
I could speak.
So basically, you lost your shy bug by being in.
Right.
The
I was kind of
wow.
thrust into it, and it kind of got me out of my shell. And
okay.
playing sports, it helped me as well.
Of course.
As I became older and more athletic, and my brothers played a big hand in that. My two older brothers played college football.
Okay.
And my
I'm just curious, what college is?
Boston College. Oh, not Boston College. Boston State College.
Okay.
My older brother Steve was mentioned amongst a bunch of All-Americans at that time.
Okay.
And when they merged with UMass Boston, they got rid of the team. So, but we come from an athletic type family, and
gotcha.
I kind of looked up to my brothers, and
sure.
And that's really how I got involved in acting, because of that fourth grade play.
Right.
And then later I became a singer at like a garage band.
You want to sing something tonight?
No, okay. I'm not going to sing tonight.
Okay, cool.
but I just.
If you guys want to do like a right. two-person glee club on song.
We'll have a barbershop. We'll get
that.
Another guy. We'll get the guy in
right.
the, you know, the camera guy or whatever. we'll have a barbershop quartet
exactly.
here.
Exactly. I would bring Mike in for that.
Right.
The big dude that you just saw.
He's a big guy.
All right, now let's, by contrast, Paul. Your turn. I assume based on what you're telling me, you weren't acting as much in the fourth grade as he was. So how did you incorporate acting into your life?
I was acting up in the fourth grade.
Oh, I was acting up. You all did that.
Again, long story short, it was 9-10 years ago. I had done a story for Rhode Island Monthly. I write for them, too.
Oh, cool.
On
I want you to also name all the pages you write for, if you can.
Well, that was one. I still write for Rhode Island Monthly, and I had done a story on Kurt Columbus, who was the then new artistic director at Trinity Rep in Providence.
Wow. Okay.
It's a very well-regarded theater.
Right.
And I interviewed him, and I talked to the people, and I went to a few shows there, and I just fell in love with it. And I realized my whole life I always wanted to be an actor, but
cool.
I just never had the guts to do it.
Right.
And my girlfriend lives in Marion, Mass, and they have a little...
Oh, great time. We had a house in Marion for 4 years.
And they got a little theater group there. Marion Arts Center has a small theater company.
Cool.
And I said, I got to do this. So I tried out, and they gave me the lead, appropriately enough, in later life, the play, by Gurney play. And as soon as I got on stage, it was like, man, this is what's been missing my whole life.
There you go.
And so I got bit bad, really bad. By the bug and did
well,
a bunch
wait a minute, what are you saying? You got bad reviews?
No, I got bit by the bug.
Oh, bit by the bug. Yeah. I'm sorry, my bad.
Yeah,
bit bad, whatever.
And then I did a bunch of shows there, and then I did a show in Fall River, and I'd done a bunch in New Bedford at Your Theater, Little Theater, Fall River, Barker Players in Providence on the east side of Providence.
Yep.
And then four or five years ago, I started to do film with some kids in Barrington.
Rhode Island.
Yeah.
Would Seth Chitwood be among those?
Seth was it, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, the web series. There were like three or four web series with him.
And doing Modern Problems at all?
No, it was in the Red Circles as a serial killer.
Okay, the Red Circles is a pretty wild one, too.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Serial killer.
Yeah, it was fun. I liked that. I like killing people.
I
love killing people.
Yeah.
And then we did other things. And then I did a commercial for a friend of mine who runs an appliance store up in Weymouth.
Okay, and TV commercial?
Yeah.
Okay, what was it?
Toma Appliances. And
Was this something? Could you see this on Boston State, on Boston
television?
Yeah,
because he's cheap, but he bought time on Nesson, so it would pop up in Red Sox games.
That's awesome.
And people would call, what are you doing on my TV?
You were the guy that dropped the nails on your head, right?
Just kidding. That was another guy. But anyway, so and then a year and a half ago, I decided I got to start getting paid for this. So I signed up with Model Club in Boston, and they've been great.
That is amazing.
So I found gigs through them.
So you're a model too?
Yeah, technically, yeah, because I've done photo shoots.
Can you tell?
We're both models.
I mean, you're a good-looking guy. Yeah. And I say that with a totally
like Zoolander,
in a heterosexually, common, way.
Looking at the monitor, my eyes are all over the place. Yeah. I'm sorry.
What I'm saying is, that's cool. You're all right. You're doing fine.
Where do I look?
You're looking fine. You just look wherever you want to. What I'm saying is, usually the models I have in here beautiful girls, you know, in short skirts.
Hey, sorry.
Right.
Hey, it's the best we could do.
That's okay.
I can put
we're
a short
more
skirt.
Yeah,
we're actors, but what
the heck? You should see the guest I have coming in on September 28th. Oy vey.
Yeah.
Nadia, her name is Naira Kadarian or something. She's told me to get almost 1,000 likes for that.
I know Naira.
Naira, yeah. Right. She's so happy to be in on Topic Time.
Well, the one thing I love...
But that's 2 weeks from now. We got to concentrate on tonight.
All right, we'll concentrate.
Talk amongst yourselves, that's fine.
So one thing I think Arthur can relate to this, whenever you go to auditions, you see a lot of the same people.
Correct.
You've been on shoots with the same people. Right. And that's what I love about it. It's a fairly small acting
community.
But you
guys don't even know each other until today. That's what I love about it.
You
look
familiar, but
maybe I've seen them at auditions.
Oh, sure. But now, you know, somebody might see the show and say, these three guys might work together. The new Three Stooges.
Absolutely, yeah. Who am I going to be? I got to be Mo.
You got to be Mo.
Yeah. You're going to be Shemp?
I'll be Shemp. I'm the ugly one.
See, I got no hair, so.
Yeah. Larry.
Hey.
You're Larry.
I could be Larry, yeah.
I see Larry. Look at that. Look at
that.
There we go. Add a couple of bra pads, right. And you're Larry, man.
Porcupine.
I channel my inner Mo Howard a lot in my work. Actually, with Mike Gonzalez.
Okay.
Or Gonza.
Michael
Gonza.
Yeah, Mike. Go ahead.
With Jimmy and Joey, we did recently.
Okay.
A couple months ago, we had a short film that Mike wrote and directed.
Okay.
And he acted in it. And I had to slap him in this in this scene. And we're playing two, like, I guess, foster brothers. And we're not blood brothers, but he's my little brother.
Okay.
And I have to, like, make sure he doesn't, you know, screw things
up. This wasn't a comical role.
This is not comical. But when I slapped him,
yeah,
I was channeling Mo Howard when he slapped, like, Larry or Curly or whatever. And when you look at, if you look at the footage, I make that face that Mo makes, like that, almost exactly like that. You do it a little better than me.
I do it because I'm a big fan.
I'm not as accomplished an actor as you are.
Let's try this again with the camera on. They didn't have the camera on me.
But I channeled, I literally thought of Mo Howard slapping someone.
Of course.
That's the only thing I could relate to. And if you look at the footage now, you'll understand what I mean. Like, what the hell? When I really slapped him, I slapped him. Mm-hmm. And that guy's a tough guy. He can take a hit.
Wow.
I mean,
is he a boxer?
I don't know, but he's pretty tough for a guy. Like, he's in good shape.
This is what you did in Mike Gonzo's school for the theatrical arts, basically? Is that what
basically,
you did?
Basically, we collaborated.
Yeah.
It's his project, but he asked me to do the scenes with him.
Okay.
And he is, I do train with him. He's
okay.
One of my,
train
he's
what?
My, he's my
for
mentor.
Acting, right?
For acting,
okay.
Yeah, he's one of my acting coaches.
I've
had many acting coaches over the last 4 years when I really got serious about doing this.
Yep.
Because I took a long period off from that play I did in fourth grade.
Okay. Yeah.
Up until and I did like some projects in college as well. I went to Suffolk University.
Okay.
They have a good program there. I majored in communications and speech.
Cool.
And I had a radio show.
Wow.
I'm trying to get some of those things.
You look like you're a sports fan, too. Do you have any sports athletes on? I mean, you said you played sports as a kid.
I did play sports as a kid, but the show that I had was just for music-related.
Okay.
Like, it really didn't have anything to do. And then I wrote radio commercials for, an ad agency that I did an internship for called Arnold & Company.
That
is
awesome.
So, yeah, like, I've had my hand in
a
lot of different
things. Did you pay for those?
I didn't get paid because I was an intern. I got credit, actually, college credit. So I was fortunate that, you know, I got involved in a lot of things and I decided what I didn't want to do. I wanted to be creative.
Right.
And they were leaning me towards doing, like, the accounting and stuff because I was a pretty good student. That I'd be working in the office.
You would have been better off having a low GPA instead, and then you could have just been
well, yeah, my GPA was average.
But you needed to have a good GPA, so it was a double-edged sword. But
basically.
But you have to adjust, roll with the punches, no pun intended.
Right, basically, okay. Yeah. So I stopped that for a while. I got married, had kids, became a football coach.
Oh, yeah, where?
At Peabody.
Peabody High?
Peabody Youth. My son is a football coach at Peabody High, though. He's an assistant coach.
Okay.
He's 22 years old.
Yeah.
And my other son wasn't a coach, but he was a very accomplished athlete.
Right.
He was an academic All-American.
Cool.
So, like I said, we continued our athletic sort of like tradition in the family with my boys.
Okay.
But they don't want to be involved in acting or anything. I could have got them in like commercials and stuff. They're physical specimens, and they're like, nah, Dad, I don't want to do that.
Okay, well, I'll be in any commercials you want.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, again, you are a specimen.
You've got like six.
You got seriously, you're in good shape.
Oh, I try,
Right.
Thank you.
Right.
57 in 2 weeks, not bad.
very good.
And you got the Mo thing going. Yeah. Look at the Mo. You got the Mo.
Yeah.
Right.
No.
I'm Mo. Yeah. He's going to be Shemp. No, you're like Shemp.
Me. He kind of looks like Mo.
You got me going here.
Right.
I like it. All right, now, Paul, let's talk about your college days. You were a college student somewhere?
A few times. It just never took.
Right, so, you know? I mean, before they expelled you from each one?
Yeah. Okay. I went to Roger Williams back in the day for like a semester and two.
Well, I figured, you know, if you're a journalist, I assume you had to learn your...
No, I just learned on the fly, believe it or not. I went to Roger Williams. I grew up in Seekonk, Mass., which is right down the road.
Yeah. I had a guest on from Seekonk a few years ago.
And I dropped out, didn't like that, and then worked, had a million different jobs, and I went to SMU, which is now UMass Dartmouth.
Right.
Played hockey there.
Oh, you're an athlete too then?
Cool. I like to think so.
You have a connection.
Yeah.
I think as much.
Well, it was the first year of ECAC. There was a club hockey team before that.
Right,
so meaning
right.
the first
Absolutely.
Year, we got our butts kicked wherever we went, but it was fun.
Right.
And I was a goalie. I'm still a goalie. I still play
You still play hockey
week.
Now?
Yeah,
That's
yeah.
great.
And I was a psych major, but I kept failing statistics because I'm horrible in math.
Why do you need the statistics to be a psych major?
Because that's part of the curriculum.
You got to
do quantitative analysis and all this stuff.
I see a shrink once every 2 weeks. We never talk math.
You should ask him. See,
I
hey,
will.
Remember quantitative and all that crap? Do you use that? And he'll
Physics.
Say no.
Yeah,
but anyway, so I dropped out, and then it's a long story, but I became was a salesman, and I became a flight attendant for 4 years back in the 70s.
You were like
when
a male stewardess.
Crazy, yeah.
Wow.
It was just
I guess you can be a male model, you can be a male stewardess too, right?
Why not? Yeah.
Sort of go together.
And handed me a bag of peanuts out in the hallway.
Yeah, see, they will always die hard.
Right.
But then, and then I got a job at the Gazette, and I finally found something they didn't at.
Now, let's talk about that segment. I'm hoping now everybody, as a host of this wonderful program, Topic Time, I am seeking to further my career, you know, upgrade it eventually. It's not a paid show here, and eventually I hope to get that, but I figure the best way to do it is with getting as much media coverage as possible. So what I want you to do, Paul, if you would, is and we'll talk about your acting right afterwards. I want you, if you want to segue from this to your acting, that's fine. But I want you to talk about that particular piece that you do for the Globe.
And
plus, by the way, you say you write for the Globe, but it's all on an internship basis. I mean, not an internship, on a freelance basis.
Mm-hmm, yes. Yeah.
Okay.
It's like you're a vendor, you're a consultant, whatever.
But that's a pretty big paper, so to have the Boston Press.
You think it would pay more, but it doesn't. But that's okay, because there's, anyway.
Right.
I started writing for them like in 97.
Right.
For Globe South.
20
mostly.
Years ago.
Yeah, but
right.
I do a lot of travel, so I do some for travel and Boston.com, a bunch of places. But Globe South is where I've been running most of the time.
Right.
Talk
about Up Close. What's that?
Up Close is like a 350-word profile of interesting people in our zone, the coverage area.
Okay.
Just from like Hull.
Hull
down. And it's interesting people like, say, you.
Oh.
Huh?
I never would have thought so.
Yeah.
But yes, you're right.
You know, a guy just like you just hit me in the hallway. So please do a story on me? I said, I don't know.
You can do one on him, too.
Yeah, well, it's a Peabody, though.
Yeah,
they have one on the North Shore.
They have one on the North Shore. They have one. Don't they have one in Metro West as well?
Yeah, it's West, North, and
West,
South.
West, North,
yeah.
and South, yeah.
And notice I said Peabody.
East,
not like
I know why they
Peabody.
Yeah,
they say Peabody.
I just figured out, listen, Paul, I figured out why they don't have a Metro East, because Metro East is the ocean. Nobody lives there except the fishes.
That's a good point.
And they don't read.
Yeah.
Right.
Anyway.
I was thinking outside the box. Yeah.
Right. Where in God's name were we in this conversation?
We're talking,
I forget.
All right, you told me.
Oh, the Globe. The Globe stuff.
The Globe, yeah.
So I write to them a bunch of places. About.com. I do a lot of Caribbean travel, so I go write about Caribbean places. It's not a bad gig, you know.
No.
I mean, the money is not good, but I get to go all over the place.
Right.
I'm going.
Did they pay your way?
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
cool. Okay. By the way, they're e-graphics. I hope you like them.
I thought I was getting a check. You said earlier we don't get paid for this.
Really? Yeah.
Well, you'll be eventually.
Well, maybe
we'll
get a gift certificate to like McDonald's there in the backdrop.
I'll take it.
You can take a nice picture of this backdrop and make it turn it into a postcard.
Absolutely.
Yeah if you want. That would be great.
That actually doesn't look. I mean, you see it and you don't.
This
get
is Route 44 at night.
But if you're in it, it's really frustrating. But just to look at the picture,
it's
kind of pretty.
Not so bad.
I agree.
Yeah.
I know, it's great to be thinking, it's great to be looking like you're stuck in traffic when there's absolutely not one car near you within 100 feet.
Right.
But anyway, so that's, I mean, in a nutshell.
Okay, well, let's talk, all right, then let's talk, now you, Paul, talk about, I want each of you, You start now. Let's, because I'm on you all now, Paul. Talk about the talk about all the acting projects you've done that you can think of. God. I saw one that you look like you're wearing a stiletto hat. What's that was?
Stiletto
what was that?
Hat.
Okay, so you had like a stiletto hat. It looked kind of like the it looked like a feather hat, feathery
fedora
hat.
Fedora?
Fedora.
Fedora. That's what I call it.
Oh, that was for Seth, one of his web series.
Okay,
I played
Seth,
a sage walking the trail, this mythical hope trail, dispensing like wisdom and to people on the trail. It was very, very lofty.
Were you the sage guy?
I was the sage. Yeah.
Cool.
I don't know who Rosemary and Thyme were, but I was the sage. Anyway, but one thing I wanted to talk about, this very important thing,
go for it,
project I'm doing now, because I love theater, started in theater, is this project called Four Legs to Stand On.
Okay.
And I was actually on a radio show in Taunton this morning talking
cool
about this. It's like a public service play, but it's about drug addiction, the opioid crisis.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's a 35-minute play that addresses a drug addiction impact on a family, and
right,
I play the father, and I wrote the ending of the father's monologue, whatever. But we've done it all over Rhode Island.
Okay.
For doctors and at a drug recovery center in Exeter, Rhode Island.
Yeah.
And just to raise awareness and to raise the stigma about addiction, and it's okay to talk about it, just get it out in the open,
you have
don't
to,
hide
because otherwise you're not going to nip it in
no,
the butt
no
if you can't.
No,
you
but
don't.
We're doing a story, we're doing a show, a public show, 24th at the Alley Theater in Middleborough.
Okay.
So that's what the radio show is about this morning. But I mean, all the acting I've done, that to me, that's the most important, because my son's a recovering addict. He's been clean for 2 years.
That's great. I sort of am too. I've been clean for 37 years.
Yeah, all right. Yeah. And you know, every day is a new day.
Yeah. But you know, let me tell you something. Speaking of that, as long as we're on that subject, my take on it, now, I don't know, I did not use heroin. I did some acid every now and then, and I smoked weed.
Yeah.
But I was definitely dependent on it because I used it every day and I like a habitual habit.
Yeah.
But what I figured out was is that when you have a vice is like a chain, and all you basically have to do, if you do something every day that you shouldn't do, this is my own experience, I can say, all you got to basically do is break one link on that chain and you got it licked. For instance, on September 2nd, 1979, that was a Sunday, that was the day before Labor Day. This is kind of a silly story. I can incorporate my own anecdotes too.
Of course.
I ran into a guy that I thought was an idiot that I knew in high school. But I'd been seeking to buy weed up at DW Field Park in Brockton, and I didn't find it. I had some in my house, but I was running out, so I needed more. But he goes, hey, Harrison, how you doing? Where are you going? I go, well, I was going to go home and smoke some weed, but I don't have much left. I have to get more. He goes, well, let's go up the park. Maybe we can get more. Well, I went back up the park with him. We didn't get any more. I mean, by the time I got home, it was too late, and I just went to bed. And I said, wait a minute, I went one day without it. I can go the rest of my life without it. And here it is, 37 years later.
Well, I got to say, it's not usually that easy.
I know that. It's not. But like I said, I didn't use the stuff that I knew a lot of people that passed because they did, and they didn't get out in time.
Yeah,
I did get out in time.
Well, in the 70s, and even when I was a flight attendant, I smoked more dope than Cheech and Chong.
There you go.
It's close.
You rake my eye.
Yeah. But anyway, this play addresses that, and it's the most important thing I've done so far because I'm personally involved in it.
Okay.
And we're doing it all over Massachusetts,
right,
for doctors' group. We're doing it at Children's Hospital.
Wow.
Yeah, and it's got a talk back, 20-minute talk back, and everybody relates to it because I always tell people, if I had a room full of people and asked how many people have been impacted by cancer, everybody's hand would go up.
Yeah, exactly.
But you say that about addiction, and many hands could go up,
right,
but they might be a little shy about it. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to say it's okay to talk about it. But so many people have been impacted, either their children, or the parents, or
right,
the friend, the family, whatever.
To some extent, we probably all were.
We all do.
Yeah. And so anyway, just trying to, like I said, raise the stigma, start the conversation, and get it out in the open and talk about it, which is happening, which is a good thing. But that's what this play addresses.
What radio station was that, WPEP?
It used to be P.
It used to be. Okay.
It's the one on Broadway.
Right. I know that's the one. They changed the call letters.
Yeah,
It's a nice little station. I know. I've been there too.
Yeah.
I did some stuff there a few years ago.
Yeah.
Well, all right. Well, but now let's talk about, I really do want to get in, talk about all the acting projects that you're currently doing, aside from the tragic stuff. I mean, I get that both of you guys have, you know, that you're good and you've been in dramatic stuff, comedic stuff. So just, you know, all right, Paul, name some projects. Besides Seth Chitwood, we know what he's done.
As an actor, Arthur knows this. You get the gigs as they come up. I've got a commercial Friday for Hartford Hospital.
Okay.
So we're
down
for that.
You're going down to Connecticut for that.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
I was just in a SAG movie, which was that SAG thing came up. in Boston a couple of weeks ago. That's this out of town production company shot in Boston because of the mass in tax incentive, the film credit.
Sure. What was the film?
How to Pick Your Second Husband First.
Okay.
It's a comedy.
I love it. That's what I was talking about.
But the gal who was in it,
I wanted to hear that.
The star who was in it, Julie Gonzalo, she was in Dodgeball. She had a part in that.
Yes.
She was in the Dallas, the TNT Dallas series.
Right. Wow.
And she's a hot ticket. She's so funny.
So I had her on the show.
Yeah. Well, she's from LA. But so that was fun. It's fun working. You know, you see people from all over, and that's what I love about film because I just love seeing how it was. I'm so new to this still, but I love seeing how it works and how it all comes together.
Right.
But he did that. I got another gig next week for an industrial video. We do, you know, you do industrial videos, corporate videos.
I don't do those.
Yeah? Well, they
pretty
very
well. Industrial.
No, I'm only
kidding.
I've done a few. I've done like three national commercials.
Oh, I talk about those?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, that's the good
stuff.
I
was in a national commercial for Lexus. I was a precision driver and a model.
Oh, yeah.
I was a stand-in for Papa John in a Ghostbusters theme commercial. Mm. A stand-in. I did a public a PSA with the Secretary of State to encourage early voting.
Okay.
Bill Galvin. Yeah. Okay. I had a principal role in that. It comes out this fall.
Forward to seeing it. Cool.
And then I did recently a GE commercial as background. I played like a paparazzi guy.
So you guys have both.
So we do like our share of commercials.
Yeah.
But I was in Ghostbusters as one of the featured ghosts at the time.
Right.
I was cast as the ghost of John Gotti.
Okay.
So and subsequently I was approached by the Gotti family, his kids.
That's so.
Yeah. So like Angel.
Yeah.
Angel Gotti, Victoria, and John Jr.
They
kind of said, "Hey, you better, you know,
you better do it right."
Yeah, you better do it. No, they didn't do that. They were very nice, and I was gracious. And
well, how did they? Well, wait, that's pretty amazing.
They found out that I was playing the ghost of their father.
Okay,
and they posted something on the social media. That's why the social media is so very important.
Exactly,
because it. Even though like there was a big hype created about just this character, like there was a lot of ghosts that were cast in this,
right?
And the actual movie when it came out didn't really develop any of them, not even Slimer, who was like the main, you know, ghost in Ghostbusters, not till the end. So like the finale scene was sort of like segueing into two sequels that Paul Feig was talking about producing, and a lot of those main casts like Melissa McCarthy and. And it's none of my business.
So wait a minute, you're saying that the Ghostbusters film that you were in highlighted the Gotti family?
No, it didn't. Ghost. But I was cast among like a handful, like there was like, let's say there was 100 ghosts in the film.
Right.
Maybe more,
I'm still trying to draw the connection between the
Because
Gottis.
They wanted gangster ghosts.
Oh, okay.
So like they had like Bugsy Siegel all these notorious, I don't know. I'm spitballing here, but I had a specific title.
Right.
But in this particular movie, which I did get a credit, and then I was uncredited because my part in the movie was so minute. I like, you know, with all the special effects and everything, you can't even tell it's me.
Yeah, I understand.
But I was, like Billy Dowd cast me as the ghost of John Gotti. That's what my call tag said.
Okay.
But their concern was, they were just like, it was a novelty to them.
Right.
Because they're currently making a movie about the life of their father called The Shadow of My Father or something like that. And John Travolta is John Gotti. But people were like responding to like this thread that one of the kids put, like one, I think it was Angel that runs their page. I don't really know.
Right.
But it said, what do you think of this guy, Arthur Hiu, playing, you know, the ghost of John Gotti?
Right.
And, like there was novelty to them. And then a bunch of people that, it was a very positive response. It was like two or three people that said, I think it's disrespectful.
Wow.
But they don't really have a choice because their father was a public figure, so to speak.
Exactly.
A notorious person.
Very
and they
notorious.
Don't own the name
right.
of that. But it's like making a movie about Abraham Lincoln
what
or
about,
Larry David.
They didn't seem to have a problem with Johnny Depp playing Whitey Bulger, did they? But that's
right,
different.
Exactly.
Alive,
well, a lot of people had a problem with that because
a
lot of victims. And
I was in that movie.
I was in Black Mass. I played four different background characters.
Okay.
And I want to make mention that if it wasn't for people like Matt Boldry and Carolyn Pickman at CP Casting and people like Kyle and Mara, And I got to make mention because that's the first major
motion picture that I was in.
Right.
As even background. Okay. And I got valuable experience in that film. I was a driver. I played an FBI agent. I got to work with...
You worked with Peter Morse? Because I interviewed him. He played John Connolly.
No, that was Joel Edgerton played John Connolly.
He did?
Yes.
Well, then,
no, Peter Morse was a cop at the
Peter
end.
Peter Morse was the guy who arrested
him. Yeah.
Oh, my bad. Yeah. Right.
I do know who he is, but right. And I was there that day, actually. Right. I was driving that day, but the day they arrested him. But I gained a lot of valuable experience through them. As well, you know, I mean, I was cast in a ton of films, featured in one film as a Secret Service agent with Frank Grillo in the Purge election year, which came out in July.
Okay.
I got killed in that. And so, like, I had to beg my wife to come actually see me get my head kind of blown to pieces.
Yeah. Cool.
But it was a big deal for me because I got bumped by James DeMonaco. But I want to make mention of something here. I want to slow it down a little. We can talk all day about all the movies we've been in and stuff. But I just want to say that the people that I meet is the most important thing about this.
Like,
my family supports me. You know, they laugh. Like, my kids laugh sometimes when I talk about my acting friends and stuff. But, like, and my wife is really on board. My wife really supports me a lot,
cool.
Stacy.
Does she act too, by the way?
No. Okay. She doesn't even like her picture taken. But and I'm not a big fan of that either.
Right.
But my thing is the people that I meet. Like, I met Joe Jaffo Carrier. He's one of my close friends. He's going to be in a big film coming up.
Okay.
A Scorsese film, Bleed for This.
Hey, I was in Shutter Island. Right. I work with Scorsese directly.
Mm-hmm. Right. So, like, Ben Younger, Chad Verdi, these people gave, you know.
What about you?
I'm in that film.
Cool.
I'm the ringside judge for the Mayweather fight.
Wow.
And I was featured. Like, I was directed by Ben Younger. It was like the highlight of my life.
I bet.
To, like, hey, can you play with this? You know, like, I'm like, what? He's talking to me. Like, so, like, it's an all-star cast.
Sure.
I mean, Miles Teller, Aaron Eckhart, Katie Seagal, Kieran Hines.
Katie Seagal, Mrs. Al Bundy.
Mm. Al's wife, yeah.
I know, that's what I said, Mrs. Al Bundy.
Yeah, Peg. Bundy. Yeah. But, yeah, it's so I'm excited about the people that I meet. Like, it's just like I've met so many people. I don't want to insult anybody.
Yeah.
By not mentioning their names, because they'll be watching the show going, well, you know, what about me?
Well,
you know, like,
on.
I can't. Everybody, you know,
too,
yeah,
eventually.
I'm not, I dropped the name, but that name that I dropped, he's going to be a big, you should have him on your show.
So he wants to be on.
His name is Joe Jaffo Carrier, and he's the real deal. He's one of the core cast members of this.
Well, definitely spread the word. You guys know who Sarah Silverman is, don't you?
Mm. Of course.
My cousin.
Right. Yes, we talked about that. Can you
get
me like?
Well,
you know,
I can't get. Last night I was with her father. We talked for. I tried to. I'm hoping that eventually we'll get her on here.
Right.
I don't think,
get her on.
I, you know,
get
I mean,
her down.
I can't ride her coattails to the top of my career. I have to do it, you know, one rung of the ladder at a time.
Right, right.
I have to prove myself
worthy.
You have
to do it. You have to earn it the
hard
way.
You know, I mean, it's not that hard. It just
earn
takes
it.
Time.
Yeah. The ladder ain't getting any younger.
No,
I'm 62.
I feel good.
Are you really?
Yeah.
Wow.
You how old?
62. Be 63 in a month.
Well,
I'm 75.
Yeah,
that's
right.
Good. That's because you look like John Gotti. That's
right?
Why he was a young looking guy.
He was 62, actually, when he died in prison.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was it of starvation?
I played a 40. I played the 40-something-year-old.
Oh, yeah.
That's why, you know, like they cast someone that was younger than me first.
Right.
And then they were trying to cast another guy that was much older than me. I'm like, John Gotti was like in his peak, was in his mid 40s to 50,
right.
Maybe. So I'm like, some of these people that they cast this one guy who was real. And then when I saw Billy Dowd, he's like, perfect.
Okay.
He's like, can you put on a few pounds? And I'm like, what do you mean? Can I put? I can certainly put the weight on. It's just hard taking it off.
Yeah. Tell me
and
about
I had to put on about a good 15, 20 pounds to fit in the clothing that they wanted me to wear for him.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So, like, I believe it or not, I went to town. Like, I worked out and I ate and I just was a gluttonous. Pink.
You went on the Atkins diet, basically.
Right, but he wasn't like a really big fat guy, but he was like a solid, stocky kind of guy. And I'm not a small person, but I had to put some weight on to play him.
Okay.
So we're about the same height, and it was fun. It was interesting.
Of course.
But, did you get rid of the weight easily enough? Or?
I got rid of it, and then I gained some of it back. Right now, I'm on, like, I'm sort of, like, I'm about 10 pounds or 12 pounds lighter than I was for Gaudi.
Okay.
So I'm around 200 pounds now.
Yeah.
But I walk around at like 190, so I got another 10 to go. And as long as I can fit on my pants, these are 34s. And
yeah.
You know, they're a little snug, but I can fit in
them.
My waist is a 32, so you're not that. You're
right, pretty, yeah. But it's like I'm sucking it
he's
in.
He's holding his breath.
You know what I mean? Right. Yeah, I'm like, you know, hey.
He's usually not that color because he's going like
right,
this.
I'm red. I'm a little bit, I'm a little nervous.
Your muscles are pumping right now.
Yeah, I'm pumped. I'm jacked. I worked out like a madman this week for you.
Yeah.
Really.
I appreciate it.
No, I really did.
I believe it.
I go crazy. I have a personal trainer, too. So.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Right. She, right.
You could be
Diane.
A personal trainer. Oh, a female? That's right.
Die Hard, her name of her gym.
Okay.
It yeah,
sounds
like, Diane
it sounds
Hughes
like it's
Culver.
Not
she's
just a cliche.
She's the real deal. She's the one who
get her on the show
responsible
too.
For this.
I love having. I've had bodybuilders on the show and trainers
right.
too.
I'm yeah. not a bodybuilder.
No, I mean
it's a
I know that, but she's
gym.
A trainer though.
Yeah. She's really good. We got to get her involved in some Hollywood type
stuff
training
yeah.
because
okay.
she's the real deal.
Cool.
There's no question. No question about it.
No, all right. We'll get her in.
I'm sorry to, you know.
No, that's good. Listen, feel free, both of you guys, to hype anyone you want.
Plug anybody we want.
Plug anybody we want. I don't know.
But that was a Gaudi reference.
Bob,
sorry
I
about that.
Question.
You got to plug anybody you want.
Hey.
Tell me about your family life. Married, single, kids.
What was the old Three Stooges thing? Are you married or happy?
Happy.
Hey,
there you go.
Yeah, happy.
Yeah.
Census taken. Census.
Right.
Anyway, I'm long time divorced.
Okay.
Yay. You know the old joke, why is divorce so expensive? Because it's worth it. And,
wow.
But I've been with the same gal for a long
time. That's right.
You
have a girlfriend, you were saying.
Yeah, yeah.
Right,
and
saying,
she,
okay.
same thing. She's very supportive. She's big on,
absolutely.
Like, you got a dream, pursue it, blah, blah, blah.
That's very important.
Oh, it's huge. Because, I mean,
totally
what's
is.
Crazier than pursuing acting is a career.
What right. about her in acting? Does she do anything?
No, same as his wife.
Same as his
she
wife.
Does
okay.
like a picture taking, right. anything. She hasn't liked the picture since like 72, the, in 1972.
Right. Well,
but she's fine. She comes to my plays or whatever and sees.
Okay.
So she's very supportive. My son, I got a daughter and who's got a child. I got a year and a half, a year old grandson.
Okay.
My son's living with me, but he's going to UMass Boston, so he's going to move up there. Like I said, 2 years clean
wow.
in recovery.
Good family.
That's good.
It is.
It's just a lot of stuff. I pick up gigs here and there. I was actually in a national commercial, an 1-800 dentist.
Cool.
Because I didn't know it was national until a friend of mine in Oregon said, you know, he texted me, he said, I just saw you like waving.
Were you a dentist? Or were
yeah,
you?
I was a dentist.
You look like you could
you
be.
Look like
yeah.
it, yeah.
You have that
yeah.
dentist look.
Look. Yeah. yeah. I'm playing a doctor.
Your arm's not quite hairy enough.
Yeah,
but
yeah, no,
huh?
My handwriting's awful. Right? But this commercial Friday is.
No
I'm playing a
dentist.
Hate
dentists
with hairy
arms, yeah. Right?
Yeah. That's right. I don't remember that. Yeah. But the commercial.
Hey, let me ask you something. When you did the dentist gig, did you do it at 2:30? Get it? 2:30?
That was
you got
neat.
That right.
I did.
Yeah. Okay.
You 2:30. Yeah, my 2:30.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm goofy like that too.
Yeah.
People don't laugh usually anymore.
Still
that
awesome.
One. Right.
Well, you know, one thing I want to say, speaking of meeting good people, it's all good people. And,
sure.
And I was in an independent film recently, and I wrote about it for the Globe.
Okay, cool.
And they had my picture
it's
on the front page.
It's nice when
you collaborate
really,
both
really
things
scary. Together.
Right. Yeah, no. But one thing I did mention, that in this realm, they call actors the talent, and that always, like, hit me funny. It's like, right. we're the talent. But it's everybody who's the talent. I
right.
mean, the guy from, you know, the gaffers, the sound people.
Sure.
Absolutely.
Craft services,
right,
which I
right,
love.
Right, right, right.
Makeup. I mean, it's all the talent. It's without everybody's effort, it wouldn't come together like it does.
Right.
But they call actors a talent. And I get it. I can understand that. But if you're not careful, that can go to your head.
I know.
But everybody's involved.
Yeah,
everybody.
Even when I do it, so I can go to your head. Listen, have you guys ever done any write? I mean, are you write for the Globe? But if either of you ever done any, like, attempted any script writing for films or plays?
Yes.
Okay, let's talk about that.
I am. And I'm not a writer by any means,
okay.
but I, like I said, I wrote like a few radio commercials.
Oh yeah, yeah,
day.
You were saying.
But like
yeah.
I wrote something recently that touched close to home. It's a screenplay I'm starting.
Okay.
It's about my father's life, and he grew up in off an island in Samos, Greece.
Oh yeah,
and,
yeah. You were telling
he
me that,
went
yeah.
through like the tail end of World War II.
Yep.
And Germans attacked his island.
Right.
And
wow.
It was
that.
Very, yeah, and he never talked about it. He passed away in January.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
And
yeah.
I found out a lot of different things over the years through other relatives, my uncles and so forth.
Yeah.
About how difficult my father's life was.
Yeah.
And I had a strained relationship with him, but it was, looking back now, I can see he had problems with addiction. He
yeah.
liked to drink and he smoked 2 packs a day.
Yeah.
But he lived to almost 80 years old.
Okay.
And he died recently of lung cancer.
Yeah.
But I think it's a story that is it's close to me. It
right.
touches me. Like every time I look at something emotional like that, I cry. I'm very sensitive.
Yeah, yeah.
So like,
sure.
it you have to get in touch with those things because people look at me. And like I have a headshot, I got to mention from Ellen Korsh.
Yeah, I saw that.
And that headshot has done more for me, and Boston Casting has done so much for me over the the last 2 or 3 years.
Right.
I've been casting so much. I got to thank Angela Perry.
Angela Perry.
And and Ellen Korsh.
Yeah.
And even Angela, Hillary.
Did she work for Boston Casting too, or was she just
who?
Ellen.
She was like a casting director, but she's like. She has her own.
I've been to that
she's
place.
A photographer.
Looks like, I don't see. It looked like no one in there would look to be over the age of 25. It's a pretty young.
No,
company.
She looks like she's 25, but she's a little bit older than that.
Yeah.
I think. I don't ask her
I
age.
Understand.
But
right.
she did a lot. Like she did a series of headshots of
okay.
me that really kind of catapulted whatever career you want to call that
exactly,
I have
yeah.
into like. Another atmosphere,
right.
And that gets me in audition rooms. Like I want to be able to prove to people when I get in an audition room that I'm not some jamoke that
right.
takes this very lightly.
Mm. Of course,
like I'm very
well. Just the way you came here today and suited up proves that.
Well, I didn't put my tie on because
well,
I didn't want to. I mean, come
yeah,
on. You know,
sure.
This guy just walked off the golf course.
Right.
But me, I just, and I try to be. Respectful to them, and Ann Mulhall and at LDI mm-hmm. casting,
so
and Slate casting,
you,
and I'm thankful to all of them.
She got,
they all
did she
get
you
work.
That role. Now you were in what did Ann Mulhall get you anything?
I was in Broad Squad.
Okay.
I was cast as a police officer,
okay.
and they used my vehicle.
Right.
So like I worked for 2.5 weeks on that show.
Hope they gave you gas money too.
No, they didn't. They paid me pretty good
I'm
though.
Sure they did.
And
yeah.
I got to work with Henry Bronstein, who
yep.
was the executive producer of. The Sopranos,
oh, wow.
and Cokie Giedrich, the director, she was good. So I'm thankful to Ann Mulhall
yeah.
and Anthony Ambrosino for casting me in that.
The show.
Right.
Yeah.
And those people, I'm very grateful to all of them.
Okay.
But really, like Angela Perry and Boston Casting, they're like the gold standard.
Well, it's nice how both you guys, obviously, you move around, you work, your venues vary, you're making references to people in Providence and Boston, which means, you're obviously widespread in terms of what
absolutely.
You're doing.
Absolutely, yeah, that's what it's all about.
What about like traveling to outside New England, or New York, L.A., any of them places? You ever been out there to do work?
I've been out there,
or will be,
yeah.
or will plan to go out
yet.
There?
Yeah. I would
I've been to New York,
job.
I don't mean for like just for leisure. I'm talking about for acting stuff.
Right. I'm in the process of doing stuff that I can't talk about.
I understand.
But I have been there a couple times.
Right. Okay.
And as well as a lot of other New England actors, they go. You go where the work
right.
is.
Exactly.
I mean, I'll go to like Bulgaria if they if
I'll
I
tell
get
you
an
one thing. Boston
to
Casting got me back on September 9th of 2009. I was actually September 11th of 2009. I went down and I got to sit in the, I got a paid role as a member of the audience in Deal or No Deal, Howie Mandel.
There you go.
In Waterbury, Connecticut. But that's the only thing they've ever, every other role, I'm very aggravated when I see, they send me emails all the time and it's never anything I qualify for. They're either looking for a 20-year-old Hispanic female or, I'm all happy doing this. I'm hoping
that
they say, this guy, somebody says, hey, Topic Time Man, that rules, let's get him, let's pay this guy, he's worth it. But still, I like to think that sooner or later I'm going to see a nice role. I mean, I've gotten plenty of roles too that are like in indie films and stuff.
Mm. Absolutely,
which is fun.
Me too.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And those are important.
I was hoping I could work with that shit.
Those are very important.
Yeah.
That's where you get to. All due respect to people. I do a lot of background, featured background stuff. But now that I'm in SAG,
you are. Yeah.
It affords me to do other things in my life because I have a family
business.
No,
you were just in SAG or SAG-AFTRA?
SAG-AFTRA, it's obviously
it's
the same
after,
thing. I say SAG just because I'm too
thing.
Lazy
think,
to say
think,
the whole thing.
SAG-AFTRA, yeah, but the difference is, from what I understand, is that if you're in SAG-AFTRA, you can do more stuff than if you're just
I guess
SAG.
So. I guess they both merge, AFTRA and SAG. And it's sort of the same thing all in one.
Okay.
So you can do TV and commercials and so forth. Mm-hmm. And
That's
my understanding.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. I've done everything. Commercials, made for TV films. I got my first speaking line in a film called Forget Me Not.
Okay.
It was a German film, and Angela Perry cast me in that.
Wow.
One of her employees, I guess, but I was picked to be in that, and I was sort of featured. I was a doorman,
okay,
and I got to have
There's the door, man.
Yeah, I'm like, hey, you know, you can't get in here, but I said it in English, and they kind of dubbed it into German.
Wow.
And then they made me say it in German as well, and then I got in another German film as a result of that, and I got to play a lawyer, so I one-upped myself.
Right,
as,
wow.
And I wasn't just playing like a tough guy. I played a lawyer,
and
I had a couple of lines in that. With the, I was a custody lawyer for the main character's daughter,
right,
and then I did another a German film where I played like a dignitary at a very fancy, you know, dinner at like a politician's house.
Cool.
And I got to speak, but they cut my lines in that one. I got, like I said, to speak in Purge,
right,
but they cut that because
what's Purge
election year. It's like the third installment of these sort of horror type action films.
Okay.
Disturbingly, like
graphic.
Maybe graphic. And,
yeah.
And there was some very good people in that too. Like London Hall was featured at the beginning of it.
I know who
she's
is.
A very, you know, like I meet some, like I say, when I'm dropping names, it's because I have a lot of respect for these people
I
meet.
Yeah.
And there's so many other actors that were in this, like Mickey Gilmore,
Leah
Placido. She was a
too.
Nurse in it. She got to put like a bandage on Frank Grillo.
Okay.
And like I noticed so many different people
I
in the film, like
body,
Michael
okay.
Swanson okay. and James Cusano, I think his name. Mm. And there's so many, there's hundreds, and I've probably met like a couple thousand
wow.
New England-based actors and a lot of really talented people.
Tell me
they
about
do
it.
Background yeah. because they need the money. They
right.
have to work. So this is a very huge, growing industry here,
yeah.
and I'm taking full advantage of it. If you look on my eye, people go, why do you put your background stuff? Yeah, well, look at what I've done.
I know.
In a very short period of time, like maybe 2.5-3 years, I've been in like, you know, 36 different productions.
Wow.
And that's like, and that's refusing to do some other things that I get asked to do, because sometimes you double book,
mm-hmm.
and
right.
it's very difficult for them to navigate through. So I'm, my business savvy and some of the other things that I'm able to do are afford me these opportunities, and
right.
I take advantage of them.
Of course.
And when other people don't, I try to help them. I'll put in a good word. Hey, you know what, Harrison, can we get him in? Mm. Like, let's get him in.
Well,
and you never know,
in.
You might get bumped up, and they'll say, hey, you know, we like this guy. He wears glasses. Let him be like a talk show host.
Well,
I don't know. You might be.
Listen, let me tell you something. Last year, I had Jeremy LeBrion on my show, and I got to play myself interviewing a time traveler in a film called American.
There you go.
These Argentinian guys.
I'm sorry.
No, that's all right. Flag of Zombie, American Invasion.
I kind of made a mistake by saying, hey, why don't we have us both on there? Because
I got to ask you.
I want to tell him real quick. I was in two German movies last year. I don't know if you were either one of them. Something by the Sea, Decision by the Sea.
Yeah, I don't think I was in that one. I was in Forget Me Not. Why Did I Say Yes?
Oh, okay.
And the other one was Forget Me Not.
Oh.
Did I say Forget
yeah,
Me
you
Not?
Did. You did.
All right, so Forget
well,
Me
forgot.
Not. See, I'm going a little.
Forget Me Not.
Right.
Yeah.
And I also want to make mention of Charlie Flannery, who recently passed away, and that's very important because he was in class with me.
He did a lot of things.
Days
he, did,
ago.
He had a show like mine.
Yeah.
Yes, he did, and he was quite a gentleman.
He was
a good man. He was very talented.
And he also loved to recite this day in history.
Right.
Yeah, that was pretty impressive too.
Right. Coming back down, all due respect to what we do.
Sure.
He's like sort of like one of my mentors, and a pioneer in New England for this type of industry.
Paul, I got to ask you, you want IMDb?
Yeah.
Oh, good, okay.
I didn't do the pay thing. What level that is, IMDb?
I don't remember. I have pictures and stuff. If you don't have pictures on it, that means...
Yeah, I know.
My Angel Cornell, my publicist, is putting pictures on for me, and they're looking great.
Yeah, you're sharp.
They're pretty
good.
Look
good in pictures.
We have them standing next to pretty girls, I do.
Right.
But
goodness. There's a lot of pretty girls you're going to have on here, right?
I've already had them, and I'll have
did
more.
You had Anastasia in here?
I did.
Yeah,
she's 23rd.
She's a really good kid.
She is.
She's like a supermodel.
I
she's
know
not
she,
like
she
a,
is a.
She
supermodel.
Is a supermodel.
I know
she is.
She's got plenty.
Naira.
Naira's going to be. I can't wait. She was in District C-11 with you. You know?
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. She was. She was.
It's so
I
nice
was
to
reporter.
See the people watching my show and they actually want to come on. I've actually got more people. I've got more people that want to come on than I have slots to fill, which is an awesome dilemma to have.
Oh.
Well, Paul, talk about your IMDb credits in the time we have left, if you can think of them. Just wondering.
Oh, God.
How much time do we have left?
That's up there. We're making the hour.
I just looked at it.
We've got 9 minutes left.
Yeah. Oh, plenty of time.
See, I'm looking everywhere else but the clock.
Okay, well, that's my job as the host.
We only have 9 minutes. Let's go.
Yeah, but that's okay. All right, go ahead.
What is it? A bunch of stuff from the web series, the Seth Chitwood stuff, all the way up to the recent things. Somehow that gets on there. I guess the producer, whoever goes on there and updates it for you, which is great.
Of course.
I'm too lazy or stupid to do it. But yeah, there's a bunch of stuff.
Lazy, stupid.
There's always something new coming up. Like I said, one of the most interesting things is they did this independent film playing an elderly man with dementia.
Okay.
And then it was about the guy who wrote it was about his dad who had dementia and died with it. So it was kind of, speaking of dads, it was kind of like a tribute to him, a little bit kind of about his life and the difficulty of dealing with somebody like that.
Was it, who was the?
Brendan Boogie.
All right, because I saw something recently that Jay Giannone did. I was at the Boston International Film Festival, and it addressed that issue of dementia and Alzheimer's, and it was a touching story that he wrote and he acted in it, and it was a very good film to see. I mean, I was there to support him, but as a result, I got to see other films at that, and I, you know. A lot of these independent films are very, very good.
And they
hit home.
You ever hear Michelle Meek? She runs.
I know of her. She's up in Maine, isn't she?
No, she's in Providence.
Okay.
She runs the Rhode Island Online Film Festival, which is going on now, I think. And there's tons of indie films. You go on and you vote for which ones you like, and then they get awards and stuff. But she's a filmmaker and a mover and a shaker in the film.
She'd be a great
business guest. She would be.
Hopefully she'll watch the show and we'll get her on.
This show, what is it here? Is it here just here, right here?
No, I got them over 15,000 YouTube hits. And by the way, By the way, just so you know, Wes Williams, who was my guest on July 6th, he went viral all of a sudden. He got over 5,500 hits in just 2 days.
He has connections.
Yeah. I know. I love it. I mean, that means we got to
get Wes to promote us. You know.
We will.
Yeah, he's in his film. Hey, Wes.
Well, you tell him. He'll see this. I mean.
I know.
You both have
Wes
a lot of
cool.
friends.
He's cool.
Really
like
good.
When I see him, he's like. Yeah, how you doing? You still doing what you do? All right, yeah, I'm doing what I do. You doing what you do? Yeah, all right, see you later. And then that's it. That's like, it's a very short, like, little interchange, and that's it. We're done.
I
was honored to be in his film.
You guys both covered a lot of stuff today. Now, one of you mentioned you do music. You said you sang. Mm-hmm. What about, you guys ever done anything else in entertainment? Then you played music, done any music videos, anything like that?
I like that. I've done musicals because I have a stage voice, but I've done a couple of musicals.
and when you do musicals, you sing in them?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. So you have done some singing too?
Yeah.
Okay.
I did some singing in classes. Show tunes and stuff like that. I was taught at a young age, but I never really did like a musical. I used to sing in a rock band.
Cool.
And I would record music.
Whatever happened to that rock band?
We kind of dissolved because we started to do studio music.
Right.
A lot of my friends are professional musicians today even. Like Brian Alex, he played in a group locally called N-Train.
Okay.
He was the lead guitarist, but he kind of does a solo thing now. Another guy that temporarily was our drummer in a band called... The name of my band in high school was Haggis Basher, and going into college.
So it's almost like Haagen-Dazs ice cream.
Well, Haggis Basher is a guy who beats the snot out of like beef. Like it's a Scottish term or something. Intestine filled meat product or whatever.
As a vegan, Haggis. I don't concur.
But anyway, that band dissolved sort of like as I grew up a little bit. And then I did some recording and stuff like that.
Okay.
But Jonathan Mover was the drummer, and he subsequently
he was the mover. You were the shaker.
He was definitely a mover, and he still is a mover. He played with Alice Cooper and Jeff Beck, and he was in a group called GTR in the 80s, where he's a real deal. He owned his own.
Yeah, and I interviewed David Hull, who actually played on Joe Perry's band.
Jonathan is very well known. It's just. Drummers in general, they're not household names unless you're Neil Peart from Rush or somebody like that. He's in that echelon of drummers.
Have either of you ever done any like stand-up comedy, anything like that?
I have.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. I did it once to write about it because I write for Rhode Island Monthly. They said, hey, it'd be good if you did a show or 5 minutes at Charlie Hall, Charlie Hall in Providence. He's a legend in the comic circles, down there, like with Frank O'Donnell and those guys. So I went down to the Foundry one night and just wrote 5 minutes of material and cool. just did it. People laughed, but I also found that if the lady go on the set, the more drunk they are, so they're going to laugh more. So it was
people
good.
People tend to want to laugh anyway, even if you're not that good. If you suck and you get in front of people, they're expecting
you to be
funny.
Just come across as a moron, and that's funny.
Right.
That's
I think it's...
It's 98% of it right there.
Yeah, exactly.
But it was fun, and they get a good column out of it, and they got a few laughs. And it was something I always wanted to try again, too. It just never happened. But who knows? Maybe I will.
I do a lot of improv stuff.
I know. I have, too.
I love that. Yeah. And I did it at the New England Actors Workshop with Erica Derrickson a while ago. She had a studio.
You guys both at her party?
I've done. No. Yes. Okay. I try to make every event that involves, Erica because she has a way of bringing people together.
She does.
And in terms of the improv comedy, I know we got like 4 minutes here, but I met some people. I met a woman named Heather Bonin.
Okay, I know who she is.
Our first scene together as an improv was to be Siamese twins.
Okay. Did you have to be joined at the hip?
We were joined at the hip.
Wow.
And it was a good concept. So we were playing like these, we lived on the second floor and she's my Siamese twin and I'm a male and she's a female. So we thought that was pretty funny. So we went with that and it was hilarious. Like looking back now, I don't remember the reactions from people because I was so into that character at that time.
Right.
And as a result, I made some good friends from meeting Erica and all these very talented people of different, backgrounds of different ages of different everything
exactly
and that's what really is what I enjoy about it. I met Paul here.
Yeah, Paul tonight. Yeah, you guys may
that's
work
funny there. Erica she did my headshots. I need
me too
one.
She's done headshots for me after Alan Kors.
She was my daughter in a movie we did a short parallel with
that was you.
Yeah.
Oh,
she's a
yeah,
good
she
actor.
My daughter and that thing with that one best short sci-fi in the Philadelphia Film Festival, which was nice.
Who wrote that, by the way? It wasn't a Seth Shitwood.
No. Mike Whistler, W-I-S-L-E-R.
He was a guest on the show, too. Right. That's what I thought. Now I remember.
Erica's energy levels off the charts. Right, I love Erica. She's
guys, that's the amount of time we have left. I hope you had fun.
I had a lot of fun.
All right, well, just 2 minutes. What are you going to do? We keep going.
Keep going. All right, you want to just give quick shouts out to people, and we're going to... There's not much time.
You've got to get rid of that.
You don't have to get rid of that.
I'm trying to think of who
to mention. This close to not swearing.
I'm very sorry.
You named everybody in your life.
They say people who curse and swear are more honest. Yeah,
that's true.
I'm not hiding anything. I think
there's
nothing to hide here.
That's one thing we can... If they want, they're not going to bleep that out. It's no big deal.
Bleep that out.
Public access television is not regulated by the FCC. There's a little slip every now and then.
Well, one thing I'd like to say, too, is we're film guys, and have you done stage at all?
I'm going to be working on a film called Back to the Sugar Shack. Not a film, a play.
Yeah.
Written by Bill Porter, a good friend of mine. It's a period piece, I think, in the 60s.
Cool.
It's like it was a real place, I guess, in Cambridge or Boston area. And I haven't done anything.
Yeah, no,
and
that's
I want it because theater actors make better film actors. Always.
Oh, no, there's no question. The thing I was going to impress on people is so much local theater around here. You know, support your local theater group.
Absolutely.
New Bedford's got your theater.
I'm going to go see Molly Weinberg when she plays in the Medford film.
Yeah, I met her recently, too. Yeah. I saw her perform in Salem.
She is an awesome, Steve Blackwood, she's an awesome actress and a great musician, too.
Yeah.
Well, guys, listen, I want to thank you guys for both coming in.
No, thank you.
And you were both wonderful. I know it's kind of hard to, I've never done this before. This is unique.
You never had
I've
two never people had, at the same time?
No, it's good. I think this is
you
good.
You never
this,
had two people?
No, I've
this
had more than one person, but usually they've known each other.
They
usually come in together.
That.
I've never had two people together that don't know each other going in.
Yeah.
Well, he booked me, right? And then I didn't get back to him. He gave me the wrong phone number to get back to him because we were talking on Facebook. And when I finally got through to him, he's like, I already booked someone. I'm like, you know what, why don't you just let him do it and I'll do it another time. He's like, it's not going to be till the spring, Arthur. Mm-hmm. I'm like, well.
He's got he had Red Sox tickets tonight.
Right, I gave up the Red Sox game to be here tonight, which is fine with me. My son's going to go sit in the rain. So let him deal with that.
And on that note, we are going to wrap it up. Thanks for watching the Topic Time.
Watch
see you
the
again
dance.
Next week. I have a pretty awesome guest to see you then next week, too. Take
all
care.
Right.
Have a nice one.
This is kind of addictive.
Is it?
You could dance like three white guys.